Good morning, everyone. This is Azad from Heritage Society. I welcome all of you to our session 5th in the National Conference on Recent Archaeological Investigation in South Asia, being jointly organized by Heritage Society and IQAC and Maharaja Lakshmi Singh Memorial College, Ellen Mithila University, Darbhanga. With us, we have Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra, who have joined from Ranchi Regional Center, ICNCA. He will be moderating the session and will be chairing the session today. With us, we have today four presenters. Sir will be introducing them later. Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra, sir, is currently serving as Regional Director of Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, Regional Center Ranchi, Ministry of Culture, Government of India. He is heading the Eastern Zone of IGNCA, Ministry of Culture, and entrusted with looking after the preservation, conservation, development, and flourishment of indigenous tribal folk art, craft, culture, and heritage of Eastern India. His area of expertise include Indian philosophy. He has studied one of the major darshan from Sudarshan of India. He is a motivational speaker as well as a philosopher. He has widely traveled throughout India and abroad and keenly observed and investigated the diverse cultural tradition, lifestyle of varied communities and their dynamics. I welcome you, sir. On behalf of Heritage Society and Ellen Mithila University, I wholeheartedly welcome you to our fifth session, sir. I now request Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra, sir, to begin the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Ajay. Let me start with some Sanskrit verses. सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अश्वदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्परां यस्यः प्रसादमवलम्ब्य जगद्गुरूणां मप्यस्खलद् बहुगुणाः प्रसरन्ति वाचः सा वेदशास्त्रपरिनिर्मितवन्द्यदेहा भूयात्समग्रवरदैवसरस्वतीनः It is my pleasure to welcome you all to this intellectually engaging and thought-provoking national conference on recent archaeological investigation in South Asia. Platform and initiative like these give us opportunity to reflect and think and ponder upon various aspects of our rich and diverse culture and heritage. At this outset, I convey my greetings to the organizers of this event, Dr. Anant Ashutosh Dwivediji and Sri Azad Hind Gulshan Nandaji. Indeed, during this challenging time of pandemic, you people worked really hard in conceptualizing this seminar and bringing all intellectuals and thinkers in one platform. As all of panelists, you are aware, in the last day of this conference, we are going to have fifth session, which is the second last session of this conference. At the outset, I welcome you all the panelists and wish you all the best. In this ongoing session, we are having five papers. They are Ms. Alisa Ali and Ms. Venu. Ms. Fatima, Jaina Fatima, and she will join, I think, after some time. Mr. Sujan Das, Mr. Shubham Pathak, who will be presenting their research paper. And all panelists, as you ever, all panelists will get exactly 15 minutes for their presenting paper. So without taking so much time, I would like to invite Ms. Alisa Ali, who is pursuing her postgraduate from Delhi Institute of Research Management. And her title of the her paper is Appraisal of Tangible and Intangible Heritage through Archaeological of Open Air Museum, Sanoli Excavation. It is from, we are going to UP, Uttar Pradesh. Then we'll have her paper. And I'll request Ms. Alisa Ali, you are kindly start your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. So my name is Alisha, and I'll be presenting my paper on the topic Appraisal of Tangible and Intangible Heritage through Archaeological Open Air Museums, with particular reference to Sanodi excavation. So in today's discussion, we'll be looking at what are actually archaeological open air museums, how intangible heritage is associated with the excavations, how what is Sanoli excavation, and what are the stories and the intangible heritage that is very unique and important, and how can we manage an open air museum site. So in our paper, what we want to understand and highlight is that whenever an excavation happens, although it's something tangible that we are discovering from an excavation, but it's the intangibility, the traditions, the culture, that the Indian culture that is associated with a particular excavation that makes it important. And it is very necessary to pass on that intangible cultural traditions along with the tangible excavated artifacts to students, to audience, to the people of India, to understand and to actually imagine what our traditional cultural past was and how do we associate with it today, and how the transition over the cultures has happened over the years and centuries till today. And with regard to this, we understand that open air museums will be a potential medium of communication between the ancient past and current times, as to how we can recreate the past using the open air museums to actually explain what how things worked out then to people of today's generation. What is an archaeological open air museum? An archaeological open air museum is an institution which is primarily based on archaeological sources and with relation to the intangible heritage resources, as well as to sound with proper scientific methods for the purpose of education, study, and enjoyment of its visitors. What are the basics of an archaeological museum? For an archaeological museum to exist, there are certain points that we need to keep in mind. Firstly is to preserve in situ conservation of the particular heritage, whether it's tangible or intangible, an identity element attached to the particular excavation site, and the tangible culture which is attached should inculcate an identity to us. An outdoor facility themed with prehistory. For an open air museum, you cannot have an open air museum in a building, because that forms the basis of an archaeological open air museum. It is supposed to be attached to the excavation site where the actual tangible remains have been found. And what can be a better site to actually create the intangibility and to form those cultural traditions in the actual site? When we talk about the intangible cultural heritage, for a long period of time, if we see over the years, the understanding that we had about the heritage was actually just related to the tangible facts, the material remains that we used to find. But then intangible cultural heritage is something which adds life to all the artifacts and all the excavations, and which actually builds in the importance of a particular excavation in South Asia or in anywhere else in the world. So intangible traditions are living or expression inherited from the ancestor, passed on to our descendants. And these can be in the form of oral tradition and performing arts that we inculcate from the finds that we get through an excavation. The Sanoli excavation is one of the most unique sites. Unique because firstly a necropolis was excavated, which was actually like a city of the dead. So it's a huge site with 116 burials, along with a lot of antiquities were discovered. There were three kinds of burials that were found. First one were the extended burials, in which an intact skeleton was found in a lying position. The symbolic burials actually didn't have any body, but then only material remains. that means maybe the person might have died and the body would not have been discovered, but a symbolic burial was carried out only with the belongings of the person. The third were the secondary burials, in which few bones were found, and the other and that is because maybe the person might have died in an accident or in an attack, in which some of the, like, half the body might have been mutilated and not being found. The third and the most important finds were the legged coffins. These two of the legged coffins were found buried with a lot of ceramic pottery, which was dated back to the OCP period. One of the legged coffins is supposed to be a royal burial because of the decorated lid it had, and it had a lot of imprints of human-like figurines, and around 8 figurines were carved out on the tin lead, along with sheathed and decorated carriers. Personal belongings of the person who was buried in this legged coffin was also there, and copper daggers as well as copper sheets were found with these legged coffins. Carriers are the second most and the important findings of this period, because the excavation material from this excavation is dated back to 2000 period, which coincides with the downfall of the Harappan civilization. But however, the Sanolian civilization is something that existed outside the Harappan civilization simultaneously, but they were somewhere in contact with each other. So the findings of the carriers is actually being associated with a lot of actually Indian heritage that date back to the pre-Aryan period. Then remains of a woman were also found lying on a coffin, and some weapons were also found underneath her coffin. So what are the important intangible ideas that we are getting from these excavations? Number one, the founding of the royal burials, which is a path-breaking, ground-breaking find in the excavation of the Indian archaeology, is because in Harappan society, there was no actual evidences of social stratification that existed. But however, the finding of this coffin tells us that there were some sort of social stratification. Also, the burying of a lot of weapons, which were actually made of copper, shows that there were the existence of warrior class. Especially, there were also women warriors, since we found a women body remains with a dagger that was actually buried underneath her coffin. The finding of the carriage has also ushered a new debate, which was whether the carriage belongs to the Mahabharata society. There are actually debates that this was one of the villages that was asked by the Pandavas. The uses of horses is actually, again, a very new debate that has come into light. The chariot is supposed to be drawn by two animals, most probably the horses. But however, as we all know, that in the Harappan society, there were actually no proper finding of horse remain. But then, whenever the report comes out, the finding of horses can be one of the most path-breaking research. So why an archaeological open-air museum? Archaeological open-air museums create an equilibrium between the archaeological findings of the past and the evidences for educational, enterprising, and presentation of archaeological data. Archaeological data acts as a primary source to reconstruct and interpret the cultures of the specific time, period, and place. Open-air archaeological museum also foster manual, mental, and historical consciousness, which is a constructive learning experience, and it's a hands-on archaeological approach towards more inclusive participation of audience and the coming new archaeologists who are students. So firstly, an archaeological museum look at the part of the education system. Second, it's a part of experimental archaeology. The International Council of Museums has this branch that deals with experimental archaeology. It is a very beneficial source of commerce, because there was an interview from the Sanoli district as well that the Pradhan was very happy with the excavation, since because it has drawn a lot of attention to their village. So when we are talking about these excavation sites, if a museum or a cultural heritage site is actually being constructed there or and associated there. So it will be a earning opportunity for all these people who are associated with the site, with the local villages. Also, in the museum there, it will be a proper living history museum, as it will be on the particular site doing the in-situ conservation of whatever artifacts that have been discovered. And again, it will be a good source of tourism activities leading to development of the village or the site that the excavation was done. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Alisa.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Your presentation was very interesting. So last we'll comment. Now I request Professor Dinesh Nandini Parihar, jinko hum Madam Venu jaise jante hain. I request Madam Venu, who is a research scholar in Pandit Ravi Shankar University, Chhattisgarh, to present her paper titled Intangible Heritage of Rock Art Gotitola. Now abhi hum log UP ki baat kiye hain, abhi bhaugolik ki drishti se hum Chhattisgarh ki taraf ja rahe hain. Abhi main Madam Venu ji ko request karta hun, wo aake apna presentation shuru kare. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Seva Johar, sir. Seva Johar, and good morning, all of you. My name is Venu Thakur from Pandit Ravi Shankar University. And today I am going to present Intangible Heritage of Rock Arts in Gotitola.
Good.
Sir, I am visible.
Yes. You are visible. Okay. Your PPT also visible. Carry on.
Okay, thank you so much. So, Gotitola basically a site name which is located in a Kanket, Chhattisgarh. So, basically, I want to give some information about rock art. What is rock art? So, the painting, engraving, brushing, and drawing on the wall and the ceiling of the cave and rock shelter are the unique and creative example of prehistoric human art. Basically, we can divide rock art into two parts, like pictographs, means painting with colors, and petroglyphs with engraving. And third one I want to add, which is geoglyphs, which is also a part of engraving, and like Kokand, Maharashtra. So the painted rock shelter are the artistic example of unique skill of our ancestors. This artistic art is continued not only for centuries, but for millions. And in the present scenario, this art has been continued by tribal people, which can be seen in the various aspects of tribal life in tribal life. So in a context of India, first discovery from Suhagi Ghat in Mirzapur district 1867 to 68 by Carlyle, sir. Then after that in Chhattisgarh, first discovery was in a Singanpur cave, Raigarh, which is discovered by Anderson. So this is the site, and ये basic एक map है छत्तीसगढ़ का, जिसमें south part है जिसे हम बस्तर division के नाम से जानते हैं, और second map में आप देख सकते हैं जो red mark है, this is the Kanket district, and the green dot where site is located, name is Gotitola. So before the start my view, मैं आपको कुछ previous work के बारे में बताना चाहूँगी. जैसे खैरागढ़ में 17 January 2005 को एक को the एक joint paper presented by the G.L. Badam, Bharti Shotri and Tapas Kumar Basak. और Bharti Shotri, she is the scholar who discovered the site name is Gotitola. And after that, 2013, one paper presented by J.R. Bhagat, who highlighted that site. And after that, the last one is Powerful Images, which is the book form. And this published in 2017 by Meenakshi Tupe Pathak and Carton. So this is the general way of Gotitola. You can see this is our hill slope mein ek, site. Hai. जब मैंने बाकी विलेजेस लोकल विलेजेस से जब बात की थी क्या यहाँ पे और रॉक शेल्टर्स थे या यहाँ पे और पेंटिंग्स थे, तो उन्होंने बताया बिफोर दैट क्योंकि वो बहुत समय से इसके आसपास के एरिया में, ये पूरा ट्राइबल एरिया है, आसपास बहुत सारे ट्राइबल्स रहते हैं, उन्होंने बताया कि आसपास इसके बहुत सारे पेंटिंग्स थे, पर बिफोर बिकॉज ऑफ द ड्यू टू द क्लाइमेट चेंजेस और वाटर्स की वजह से अभी सिर्फ हमें एक फ्रेम ही बस यहाँ पे नजर आ रहा है. सो दिस इज द फेमस पेंटिंग इन छत्तीसगढ़. Why I am saying is famous painting because one of the once upon a time in 2013-14, it's very famous because it's called as an alien painting. You can see कि इसका जो structure है, जो making structure है, it seems not like a common man. इसलिए ये जो painting है, ये जो site है, ये alien painting के नाम से बहुत famous हुई. You can go to the through to the YouTube channel. You can see the same line. They are called as an alien painting. उसके बाद सम अनदर नेम्स भी हमें मिलते हैं, जैसे पांच पांडव गुफा. सम स्कॉलर्स ने इसे पांच पांडव गुफा यानी कि महाभारत से जोड़ने का प्रयत्न किया है, क्योंकि आप इसमें पांच ह्यूमन फिगर्स जो प्रोमिनेंट नजर आ रहे हैं आप उसे देख सकते हैं. परंतु मैं आपका ध्यान एक आकर्षित करना चाहूंगी, जब आप इस तरफ जाएंगे राइट लेफ्ट साइड पे तो आपको एक और फिगर नजर आएगा, और यहाँ पे भी एक फिगर था. ड्यू टू द रेन ये ऑलरेडी कहीं पूरा खराब हो चुका है, इसलिए हमें प्रॉब्लम फाइव पे नजर आता है. इसलिए स्कॉलर्स ने इसे पांच पांडव गुफा के नाम से कहा है. कुछ समय के बाद कुछ हिस्टोरिकल फेज में एक जोगी यहाँ आके रहने लगे, इसलिए इस जगह को जोगी जोगदेव गुफा या जोगी गुफा के नाम से जाना है. बट इफ यू आर गोइंग टू आस्क एनी ट्राइबल पीपल व्हाट इज अबाउट व्हाट दे आर सेइंग अबाउट दिस पेंटिंग, दे आर से कि ये हमारे दादा के दादा के दादा के दादा के दादा के दादा के द्वारा बनाया गया है. मीन्स It belongs to their ancestors. So, except this huge figures, I observed the many other figures, other older features than the जो कि अभी हमें background में दिख रहा है. आप अगर ये yellow figures देखेंगे जहाँ पे मैंने boxes बनाए हैं, this the geometric forms में यहाँ पे हिरन के figures हैं, ये भी geometric forms एक animal है, but I don't know is identified. And except that many other यहाँ पे ज्योमेट्रिक फिगर्स हैं, बिकॉज ऑफ द सुपर इम्पोजिशन ऑफ द पेंटिंग्स इट्स नॉट विजिबल वेरी क्लियरली. एंड टू थ्री फिगर्स यहाँ पे हैं जो कि ह्यूमन फिगर्स हैं. देन यू कैन सी दिस ऑल्सो दिस फिगर्स विच इज हैविंग अ हेड गियर्स. यू कैन फाइंड सम पाम प्रिंट्स ऑल्सो. आई वॉन्ट टू दिस पाम प्रिंट दे गोंडी पीपल्स एंड मीन्स यहाँ पे जो अराउंड फिगर अराउंड जो एरिया है यहाँ पे गोंड जो ट्राइब है वो रहती है. और ये जो गोंडी लैंग्वेज में इसे कहती है लहू हाथा. लहू इज द गोंडी वर्ड मीन्स रेड एंड हाथा मीन्स हैंड. सो दे कॉल्ड इज अ लहू हाथा. दे हैव ओन बिलीव बिसाइड दिस एंड सम आल्सो द मेन फिगर यू कैन सी इट. सो जो उस पेंटिंग में नजर नहीं आया था जो कि ऊपर साइड पे था, तो ये कुछ पेंटिंग्स है. आप देख सकते हैं कि इसमें एक डार्क ब्लू कलर से उसका आंखें बनाया गया है, देन अदर कलर्स उसको पेंट करने की कोशिश की
गई है. एक्सक्यूज मी.
यस सर.
आपका पीपीटी बस स्टैग्नेट पहला ही स्लाइड से ये अभी भी रुका हुआ है.
ओ माय गॉड.
यस
सर. नाउ इट्स विजिबल सर.
अभी तो विजिबल है, पहले तो पहला ही. हां ये अभी अभी. यस प्लीज.
ओ माय गॉड. सर एक्चुअली मैंने फुल स्क्रीन किया था ना, शायद शो नहीं कर रहा था.
नहीं ठीक है.
सो मैंने आपको अभी जो पेंटिंग्स की बात बताई थी वो ये पेंटिंग्स हैं जो अलग अलग हमें इस पेंटिंग्स के बिहाइंड बहुत सारी पेंटिंग्स मिलती हैं जो कि इससे पहले की पेंटिंग्स है जो कि ज्योमेट्रिक फॉर्म्स में है. बिकॉज ऑफ सुपर इम्पोजिशन वी कैन अभी विजिबली उसका विजिबिलिटी बहुत कम है. सो ये वहीं पे ही ऊपर की तरफ है. क्यों हम इसे बार बार एलियन पेंटिंग्स के नाम से है, क्योंकि यू कैन सी द स्ट्रक्चर कैसे उन्होंने पेंटिंग मेक किया है. यहाँ पे इन्होंने गेरू रंग का आउटलाइन बनाकर उसके ऊपर उसके अंदर कलर पेंट किया है, और साथ ही में आप देख सकते हैं ये अजीब से बहुत अलग से हेड गियर है. इट्स नॉट अ कॉमन जो कि नॉर्मल कॉमन पीपल्स नहीं मिलते. बट अभी नेक्स्ट स्लाइड में जब मैं आपको और स्लाइड्स दिखाऊंगी जिसमें आप देखेंगे कि अभी ट्राइबल पीपल्स सेम इस प्रकार के जो हेड गियर्स है वो अभी भी यूज करते हैं. सो एक उसका अब मैं इंटेंजिबल हेरिटेज की तरफ जाती हूँ कि क्या ट्राइबल बिलीव करते हैं और क्या वो सोचते हैं इस पेंटिंग्स के बारे में. जैसे कि मैंने आपको बताया कि ये सकते हैं कि ये जो पेंटिंग्स है ये इनके दादा के दादा के दादा के दादा के द्वारा बनाई गई पेंटिंग है, ये एंसेस्टर्स की पेंटिंग है, इसलिए अब अभी भी ओकेजनली वो वहाँ जाके उनको सेवा देते हैं, मीन्स उस जगह में वर्कशॉप करते हैं जाके। और इस सेवन फिगर, बिकॉज आई टोल्ड यू कि ये जो प्रोमिनेंट हमें फाइव फिगर्स तो नजर आ रहे हैं, परंतु इसकी आगे साइड में और राइट साइड में और लेफ्ट साइड में सेवन फिगर्स थे, बट अभी ये विजिबल नहीं है। तो टोटल सेवन फिगर्स जो है, इनके गोन गोन जो ट्राइब है उसके जो प्रमुख देवता है, जो पेन है वो लिंगो पेन है और लिंगो की सात पत्नियां थी। तो ये प्रेजेंट करती है उनके बिलीफ में कि ये लिंगो की सेवन पत्नियां हैं, जो कि उनके बच्चों के साथ है, जो कि पेंटिंग में पूरी तरह से नजर नहीं आ रहे हैं, परंतु मैंने बगल में फोटोशॉप से उसको कोशिश किया है कोई इनहाइट करने का, तो आप देख सकते हैं कि बच्चों के साथ है। तो एक मान्यता है कि ये लिंगों की सात पत्नियां हैं, जो कि अभी स्टिल वो पूजी जाती हैं, स्टिल वो उनके 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 लाइफ में, उनके कस्टम में है। और दूसरा एक और बिलीफ है जो बोन ट्राइब का है, जो कि सेवन कैनास का है। सेवन कैनास, कैनास मतलब गर्ल्स, मीन्स विच इज नॉट मैरिड। जैसे हम नॉर्मली एक आपको एग्जाम्पल देती हूँ, जब हम अभी अपने घर के बारे में सोचते हैं, घर बनाने के सोचते हैं, तो आज हमारा घर बिल्डर बनाता है, जहाँ बिल्डर बोलेगा घर यहाँ जगह है हम वहाँ रहते हैं। परंतु अभी भी एट द प्रेजेंट डे इन 2020 अभी भी वहाँ जो गांव का निर्माण है वो ऐसे ही कहीं पे नहीं किया जाता। गांव का निर्माण करता होता है भूमियार, जिसे भूमियार कहा जाता है। और जब वो गांव का निर्माण करता है तो उस गाँव के निर्माण में राव के साथ साथ 10 कन्याएं कहना होती है, जो गांव का निर्माण करने में सहायक होती है, मतलब उसको प्रोटेक्ट करती है बाहरी हवा से, बाहरी चीजों से, बुरी चीजों से। वो उसके सीमा का निर्धारण करती है, जो कि मैंने अभी भी प्रेजेंट में देखा कि वो कैसे होता है। तो ये जो बिलीफ है, ये इनटेंजिबल हेरिटेज है जो हमें कलेक्ट करना चाहिए, जो कि डे बाय डे ड्यूरिंग टू इन्फ्लुएंस ऑफ द अदर कम्युनिटीज और बाकी चीजों की वजह से जो अपनी संस्कृति से भूल रहे हैं, और जो हमें इंटेंजिबल पार्ट है वो कहीं ना कहीं मिस होते जा रहे हैं, जो हमें कलेक्ट करनी चाहिए। सो आप नेक्स्ट स्लाइड में देख सकते हैं क्यों मैं बोल रही हूँ कि ये वुमेन फिगर्स है, व्हाई आई एम टेलिंग, क्योंकि आप देख सकते हैं कि इस पेंटिंग में एक अलग सा एक बैंड नजर आ रहा होगा, जो कि डार्क क्रिस कलर में है। आप देखेंगे कि वहां पे जो गोटी पीपल हैं, जो लड़कियां हैं, उनको लया कहते हैं हम गोटी लैंग्वेज में, वो कुंदरा लगाती हैं, बहुत ऐसे बहुत सुंदर से ऐसे लगाए रहती है, जो कि माइट बी पॉसिबल कि किसी ने जब उस टाइम किया, जब ये बनाया होगा पेंटिंग, तो डेफिनेटली वो वहाँ पे ट्राइबल पीपल्स थे, जो ये जल्दी में, ये नहीं कह रही हूँ कि वो अभी से पहन रहे हैं, बहुत सारे जैसे कि हमने बताया कि दादा के दादा के दादा के दादा पर दादा से वो वही है। तो उन्होंने डेफिनेटली उसको प्रेजेंट करने के लिए, ऐसा दिखाने के लिए वो अलग सा एक रेड कलर का हाईलाइट किया है, जिससे वो एज अ फिगर एलियन दिख रहा है, परंतु डेफिनेटली एज अ ह्यूमन फिगर के हेड गियर्स को, उसके ऑर्नामेंट्स को एक तरीके से प्रेजेंट कर रहा है। यहाँ पे मैंने तीन फोटोज डाली है, यू कैन सी द ऑर्नामेंट्स ऑफ द ट्राइबल पीपल विच इज स्टिल दे आर यूजिंग, एंड दैट इज अनदर वन मैंने, जहाँ पे आप देख सकते हैं कि सिक्स ह्यूमन फिगर्स हैं, और जहाँ पे लंबे लंबे से हेड गियर्स हैं। ये जो हेड गियर्स है, ये अभी भी प्रोमिनेंट अलग अलग ओकेजनली अलग अलग महोत्सव में वुमेन्स के द्वारा और वुमेन्स के द्वारा और मेल फीमेल दोनों के द्वारा जो है ये पहना जाता है। और मोस्ट प्रोमिनेंटली ये होता है कि जो पीकॉक फैदर्स है उसका वो यूज करते हैं। जैसे आप ये वाले पेंटिंग में देख सकते हैं, जिसमें दो मेल हैं जो कि बाग करके खड़े होकर बहुत बड़े बड़े उन्होंने पीकॉक फैदर्स लगाए हुए हैं। ये पुश कोलांग गोटुल, अगर आप लोग जानते होंगे कि जो गोन ट्राइब है उसमें गोटुल का बहुत महत्वपूर्ण स्थान है, जो उनका एजुकेशन सिस्टम है उसमें महत्वपूर्ण स्थान है। वहाँ उनका जब विकास होता है तो बहुत अलग अलग स्टेज है, जिसमें से एक स्टेज होता है जहाँ वो पुश कोलांग करने जाते हैं, नृत्य करने जाते हैं, जो पुरुषों द्वारा होता है। और वो उस समय ये लंबे लंबे जो हेड गियर्स के रूप में ये पीकॉक फैदर है उसका प्रयोग करते हैं। और अदर लास्ट वन स्लाइड यू कैन सी द कि कितने सारे अलग अलग हेड गियर्स हैं, फिगर्स हैं, जिसको आज भी जो हमारा ट्राइबल लोग हैं वो अभी भी यूज करते हैं। तो हमें कहीं ना कहीं, मुझे लगता है, मिस प्रेजेंट के मैं ये बताना चाह रही हूँ कि इंटेंजिबल कल्चर हमारे लिए बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है, टेंजिबल कल्चर को प्रूफ करने के इंटेंजिबल कल्चर देने का महत्वपूर्ण होता है. ड्यू टू माय ऑब्जर्वेशन एंड माय एक्सप्लोरेशन मैंने देखा कि बहुत सारे आर्कियोलॉजिकल जो मटेरियल्स है जो कि कल्चर जो मटेरियल्स है वो अभी भी स्टिल मैनी ट्राइबल्स एरिया में बहुत सारे ट्राइबल पीपल के द्वारा वो अभी भी यूज किया जाता है. तो दिस इज माई पेपर. थैंक यू सो मच सर.
थैंक यू मैडम. नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट मिस्टर सुजान दास हु इज करेंटली वर्किंग एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट बनारहाट कार्तिक उराव हिंदी गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज एंड ही विल स्पीक अबाउट हिज टॉपिक इज एक्सप्लोरिंग हिस्ट्री ऑफ बंसनमरी राजपूत ऑफ कामठ किंगडम एंड अनअर्थड जीनिसिस ऑफ अर्दन आर्कोलॉजिकल साइट ऑफ नॉर्थ बंगाल. अभी हम यूपी से छत्तीसगढ़ गए और अभी हम बंगाल की तरफ आ रहे हैं. So now I request Mr. Sujan Das, please carry for your research paper. Thank you.
Good morning, Chairperson, and I would like to thank for giving me opportunity to present here my research, my paper on exploring history of the Goshenemari Rajput and Kamta Kingdom and unearthed genesis of Arden archaeological site of North Bengal. Am I audible?
Yes. You are audible. Absolutely.
My PPT is visible, sir?
No. Your PPT is not visible now. No.
It's not visible?
No.
Okay.
You are visible, but your PPT is not visible.
Sir, now?
No at all. Nahi, Sujan.
PPT nahi visible ho raha hai. Wait. Sir, let me allow. Sir,
नहीं, आपका पीपीटी नहीं विजिबल है. चलो आप.
सर, विजिबल ना हो?
नहीं, विजिबल नहीं है. हाँ, अभी अभी कुछ आने वाला है लग रहा है. यस
विजिबल सर.
यस नाउ इट इज विजिबल.
ओके थैंक यू वेरी मच.
ओके
गुड मॉर्निंग सर. आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक आर्कियोलॉजिकल एक्सप्लोरेशन एंड एक्सकवेशन डिपार्टमेंट हेरिटेज सोसाइटी पटना. नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू प्रेजेंट माय पेपर व्हिच इज ऑन एक्सप्लोरिंग हिस्ट्री ऑफ गोशनिमनी राजपूत ऑफ कामता किंगडम एंड अनअर्थिंग जेनेसिस ऑफ अर्दन आर्कियोलॉजिकल साइट ऑफ North Bengal.
Mm-hmm.
So, Goshenemari Rajput is an important archaeological site of North Bengal, which is located at Khalisha Goshenemari village of Dinata police station in the district of Kosbihar.
Mm.
Now, this area and site contain the reigning city of ancient capital of Kamta Kingdom. So mm-hmm. Now here is the historicity and antiquity. This site first visited by Hamilton Buchanan in the year of 1880 and later on visited by Rakhaldas M.S. Bhatt, and subsequently later on Archaeological Survey of India
mm-hmm.
has carried digging and excavation in 2 years in between 1998 and 2000 year of 2000. Now mm-hmm. come to the location site landscape Goshenemari and Goshenemari Rajput. This is the site map drawn by the Archaeological Survey of India. Drawn by the Archaeological Survey of India. This is the satellite image. The laser marked image of the range site of Goshen. In the top of the Rajpot, which is actually mount, height nearby 40 foot high from the level of ground level. In the top of the Rajpot, two marvelous brick made oil now in present and royal place with the passage of time. Disappear. The range site of this whole area remain unexcavated. Archaeological Survey of India only carried excavation in this area, which is rampart wall for the fortification of this royal palace or citadel area of the Rajpot. So now this map drawn by the Archaeological Survey of India. Now come to the location of this. Actually, Goshenibari Rajpot in the range test, which was actually located in the central citadel area, and citadel area was surrounded by the large number of area which came under the jurisdiction of Kamtapur kingdom, and the whole area fortified by rampart wall, which is mound nearby in actual territory, which was in 40 foot height and in width 200 foot. Now we are looking this site in dilapidated, and these are the entry actually which was the gateway. There are seven gateway, namely Shilduar. Duar means gateway or entrance. Bagduar, Sonnashi Duar, Joy Duar, Nimai Duar, and Hek Duar. Shilduar indicate the existence of gateway made of stone, means stone made gateway or torono or gateway. Bagduar, Sonnashi Duar indicate the monk entrance. Monk could enter with this gateway. Joy Duar indicate when Khen kingdoms obtained their victories, they enter this doorway. Nimai Duar indicate the Chaitanya Das, Sonnashi Nimai of Bengal, Vaishnavi saint who visited this kingdom, and that's this name Nimai Duar. Now let us slide the historical background. In the Puranas and Tantras also mentions Kamtapur as a part of ancient Kamrup kingdom, occupying large part of Kamrup and Bongo. Kamtapur seemed to be served as a subsidiary area between Kamrup and Bongo. Kamtapur became prominent in the limelight of history when a powerful kingdom, Big Arrows, under the dynastical rule of Khen dynasty, namely Nilodosh, Chakradosh, and Nilambar. Nilambar was the last historical king who was defeated by the Alauddin Hussein Shah of Gour. So, after that, the Khen dynasty or ancient Kamtapur dynasty became under the jurisdiction of Koch kingdom, which was established by Bishwa Singh Koch. Now, what contains today is a range site. The excavation of Goshenibari Rajpot took place by Archaeological Survey of India in the year of 1998 to 2000. This is the site wall located in the ground level of the mound Rajpot. Goshenibari Rajpot in the ground level excavation. The whole Rajpot fortified with rampart wall or enclosure wall in the ground level to protect the enemies or foreigners and to protect the flood. Because Goshenibari Rajpot or ancient kingdom of Goshenibari located nearby Dhorla River. And there are number of references in the Goshani Mongol Kabbo, a poetic works, a literary works of 16th century, mention the number of flood will demolish the wall of the Goshenibari Rajpot number, and the Khen kingdom repeatedly renovated and reconstruct it with reusing brick. So this is the picture report in the report of the Archaeological Survey of India. Now present condition of this rampart wall, fortification wall, enclosure wall. Second slide, on the surface of the mound or citadel area of the Rajput, there are two marvelous pre-made oil. The oil, in the center of the oil, a circular tank or pond, and in the whole area covered by a platform. A platform, there is also a stair step for entry. These are the breathing area. The traditional or oral history mentioned only the king's men and his ladies, means king and queen, used to bathe in these places. That means these two breath or oil used for all the royal kings and kingsmen. These two oil constructed with brick and brick bust. These are the brick bust, not exactly big. The sidewall by brick, and this is a big bust. There are two. One, both are similar, just central area is different. It's a circular and pedestal was square. Pedestal is square. Later, after the 2 years successive digging, Archaeological Survey of India discover number of artifacts, panels, carvings, stone making dishes, utensil, and for the preservation, Archaeological Survey of India constructed this sculptural shed cum museum for the preservation of artifacts or findings. And this sculptural shed actually located in the ground level area. This is the high level mound. So in the interior picture of this museum, interior picture, there is Shivlinga, a number of stones carving, relief carvings or panel carvings. These are these potteries, and let us look in detail. These are the pottery. The panel carving of female figuring, all the figures carved on the surface of the stone. This stone most probably collected from local areas. This stone and pieces of the stone, slab of the stone is not clear or polished in proper way, and surface of these deities, female deities. This piece was most beautifully carved. Three are female divine, and most probably their character is not identical, but suggest they are Chondi, another name of Parvati, and this Khen ruler were follower of the Shaivit. That is why all the female figure, this probably like this Shaivit, they had her sheep worship as a the primitive, and Parvati as a Chondi. This is the stone pottery. Various type of stone pottery are kept in this sculptural shed near the Rajput mound. Potteries mainly comprise red ware, grey ware, black ware, made of stone, including vases, bowls, miniature pot, bakers. This is the bakers. Another slide, recent finding at Goshanamari Rajput, including stone made grinding digs. These are the stone made grinding digs with the help of stick. People could grind any kind of cereal, any kind of, but this made of wood in modern times. This is made of stone, which is existed nearly nearly 16th century AD stone. Now at the conclusion, excavation at Goshane Mari Rajput in two successive years, in the year of 1918 and 2000, has pushed back the antiquity of the site to about 1500 years back, nearly unlimited times, 10th to 12th century. Structure and marvelous big wall and rampart wall bespeak high archaeological feat of builders with profound archaeological knowledge, but after two successive digging, having enormous historical artifacts, Archaeological Survey of India under Eastern Circle Kolkata discontinued excavation at Goshane Mari Rajput. After that, no excavation has yet been carried out, but day after day, historical remaining have been discovering from the adjacent area, either by the local people, whenever the farmer plowing their field, they found lot of historical remaining. And there is need a further excavation of to explore the enormous historical evidence buried here and there at Goshane Mari and adjacent areas. So now, after elaborating this evidence, we can guess the historical existence of almighty Kamtapur kingdom, but history of Kamtapur kingdom yet need to reconstruct, because there is no written history about the Khen dynasty, and which is existed as a buffer state between Bongo mean Hushanshahi dynasty in Bongo Gore, and the buffer state Ahom kingdom, Kamrup. But what is the link between the Ahom and the Gore is not clear, and what is the link between the Kosh kingdom and the Kamtapur kingdom. But if Archaeological Survey of India carried excavation in the whole area, this area will reveal the settlement pattern and the antiquity of this remain, which can produce linkage between the contemporary kingdom Kamrup and Bongo and succeeding kingdom of Kosh. Kosh Bihar kingdom, which is founded by Bishwa Singha. So now still the local people, educationalists and heritage society of Kosh Bihar demanded and drafted a memorandum to the Archaeological Survey of India for further excavation, and they also demanded to declare this site as a heritage for to the central government. Still after year of 2000, no such excavation has yet been carried out in this area. People of these areas actually looted this remains of stone wall for their domestic building. So no such preservation. Even this cultural shed of this sculptural shed come museum closed. It is not open. No employees work now here. It is totally closed. Even we see this satellite image, we can visualize. Actually, if we compare the other part of the fort of the India, we can visualize the earlier kings always used to build fort or citadel area surrounded by the embankment or entrance to protect the enemies. These are the indication. These are the digging area, embankment. These are the rampant wall or enclosure wall to protect from enemies. So, if Archaeological Survey of India carried the full excavation in the surface of this citadel area, it will reveal the settlement pattern of the royal place. It will reveal the settlement pattern of these advanced areas also. Even another question: if the royal place was actually situated in this area, there must have been embankment or intents or diseases in the surrounding whole area. Now, with the passage of time, this whole area with the agricultural land, people settle there, because the ancient city actually existed in the 9th to 10th century in the first place, because Archaeological Survey of India categorized in the three phases, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. First phase belonged to the Pal and Seno period. Second phase belonged to the Khen dynasty, and third phase belonged to the Kosh kingdom. So without any further excavation, it is difficult to reconstruct the history of the Goshanebari Rajput. So people of this area, administrator of this area, demanded for the further excavation of the historical site. Still, the visitors, traveler, come to visit to see this marvelous big made oil, which I have shown in the later slide. These are the wonderful skill of craftsmanship in early medieval India, which is still existence. And the surface, if you see the surface, these are not fully made of brick. It's a brick blast, and they use also mortars to binding this each binding the each stone and brick. This is surface oil polish and smooth. They also polish the surface of the brick. And the whole area frames with the bamboo fences. No preservation method yet been deployed by the Archaeological Survey of India. It is totally fully open to the 24-hour to the visitor and the local people. So until this area possesses enormous historical evidence, but it need to be still earthen in this soil of the Kosbihar Goshanebari village. So now I would like to say that the after successive digging, this history can be reconstructed, but without excavation we can say that this stone culture must indicate the existence of stone factory nearby areas or within this royal place, because without existence of stone making factory, this utensil, pottery might not have exist. So this indicates the existence of the stone making factory near the adjacent area. This also indicates this settlement pattern, the stone tools, stone utensil, pottery, stone making ware, oil is smooth, and most probably the local craftsmen used a chisel to carve and smoothing. All are not granite stone, I mean not limestone, granite stone. There was nearby There is nearby 14 in number stone carvings panel. It is a Shivlingo. So all are preserved under the sculptural state, and which have been discovered from the digging area by Archaeological Survey of India. All this pottery have not been discovered in the digging area. Most probably, this is collected from the adjacent area. This indicates the existence of the historical settlement pattern. And not only in the recent decade, in the year of 2018, became discovered by a villageman. Who is nearby 100 kilometer long in Arden tunnel in the outside area. This indicate the Khen kings most probably managed to collect the water supply to cover this water, cover this rampant area, because we have seen we can see the any the citadel area or fort of any other part of India, the citadel, main citadel area, fortified with the embankment of water, so that king could protection or suppress the foreign attack. So the all this area disappear, but in the surface area, a number of uncountable stone block lied in the surface, which indicate the existence of either temple or the existence of royal place. Most probably, they use the brick for the royal place, but stone column or stone slab used in the as a pillar. These are scattered here and there. There is no excavation carried out by the Archaeological Survey of India in the surface of this mound. Archaeological Survey of India carried out excavation in this site, which reveal a rampant massive rampant wall, actually niches, and the bottom of this this area, there is also room. This indicate this room also must have preserved for the purpose of security. This area must have been the embankment area. So this is what I try to present here, the unearthed genesis. There is no concrete history. All are barren in the soil. There is need further excavation which will reveal the history of the post Kamthapur and Goshanamari, the city of ancient Kamthapur kingdom. So I want to end here. Thank you,
dear Sujan. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. Good. As we are traveled from Uttar Pradesh to Chhattisgarh, again Chhattisgarh to again we came here, your Bengal. Now okay. We are going to Jharkhand. So now I invite Mr. Shubham Rajab, who is a PhD research student at Department of Archaeology from Deccan College, Pune, to present his paper titled Rock Art at Isko Hazaribagh District, Jharkhand, and its anthropological perspective. Now I request Mr. Shubham Rajab, please carry on for your presentation. Thank you. Shubham, dear Shubham, you are not audible. No, you are not audible, Shubham. Can you check your mic, please? Yes. Now, unmute. Please unmute. Now you are muted. Please unmute. Shubham. Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, now you are audible. Yes.
Thanks.
Carry on. Good. Again, you are not audible. No, your PPT is ready, but you are not audible. Please unmute. No, you are muted. Please unmute it.
Okay.
Yes.
Is it okay now?
Yes, now it's okay. Yes.
So, hello everyone, yes. I am Shubham Rajab from Deccan College, Pune. My today's topic is rock art at Isko Hazaribagh District, Jharkhand, anthropological perspective. This was a small research project carried out in North Karampura Valley. The rock art shelter of Isko is a well-known rock art site in Hazaribagh District, Jharkhand. The present research is carried out to to understand the prehistoric and present cultural context of Badkawa block of Jharkhand by drawing a general comparative analogy between rock art and ISKCON, an ethnic tradition. Interpretation of symbol of rock art has been attempted with the help of ethnographic study of painting, symbolic belief, tattoos, religious customs of Munda, Birhur and Orao communities in the study area. The recent find of the microliths near ISKCON rock shelter can be useful to understanding the chronology and identify the author of rock art. So aims and objective of my research, this research is carried out as a pilot project funded by Nehru Trust for Indian Collection at Victoria and Albert Museum, London, for intensive study of rock art and tribal heritage in North Karampura Valley project. This research is carried out as a preliminary documentation and interpretation of prehistoric rock art for reconstruction of human society, 3D documentation of rock shelter, and the ethnographic finding for the parallels of rock art for the better understanding of rock art in present and past societies. As the Badkawa block is under coal mining zone, so the archaeological sites in especially the prehistoric sites located in Badkawa block are still in danger. So adopted methods exploration with the help of topot seats including 33E by 1 and 37E by 1 and 73E by 5, rock shelter and open air prehistoric sites are documented with the help of ISRO satellite image and Google Earth, and using QGIS software, 3D documentation by using AGIS photogrammetric software, and ethnographic study in Sohrai and Khawar painting of Munda, Birhur and Orao communities. So here you can see it is whole North Karampura Valley. Here it is Damodar Valley. Okay, you can see Damodar River which flew here. Okay, it is Hazaribagh district and Badkawa block, Chatra hill range known as the Mahundi range, Ramgarh district, and further here it is Ranchi. Okay, and it is Tandava forest. I carried out my preliminary research in Sathi range. So ISKCON rock shelter is located somewhere here. Okay, you can see geology of Badkawa block. This is map of Badkawa block and geological map of Badkawa block. You can see dam, digital elevation model of Badkawa block. So it is the center Badkawa, and here it is ISKCON, and these are some rivers in Badkawa block, some major rivers. So now I will start on rock art of ISKCON. The rock shelter, it is the lat-long of rock shelter. The rock shelter is present in southeastern portion of Sathi Hills in the ISKCON village of western part of Badkawa block, Hazaribagh district, Jharkhand. It is the east-facing rock shelter present in long nala kind of depression. Early works, here I written the works of rock art, and this site was first discovered by Father Tony Herbert in 1992 and further studied by Bullu Imam and Dr. Somnath Chakravarti in 1996. But there were some faults, and this site is under destruction. So that's why I started my 3D documentation and interpretation. So here you can see map of Jharkhand, and here it is Hazaribagh, and it is the Sathi range, and here it is ISKCON. And it is the elevation of ISKCON. Here you can see 1,400 feet. It is the FCC image, false color composition, which is the remote sensing image of this North Karampura Valley. I zoomed especially in Sathi range. If you remember here, this one is Sathi range, and I digitalized and tried to understand the landscape, because what I basically consider that only the archaeological site is not more important. Even we can study the surrounding landscape, the people living there. So we identify several small nalas, paleo channels, which could be helpful for a prehistorical society. Okay, so the red portion are highly vegetation in the forested area and the hilly area. So these are hills. This one is river. So you can see another river here. Okay, so these are a very small river. We call it Nala or Paleo Channel. So it is a Paleo Channel. Okay, you can see a Paleo Channel. So why Isco Rock Shelter and the early settlers, prehistoric society, prehistoric people settled in Isco because of this Paleo Channels. So so here it is dam. Here, as I said, Isco, and it is contour map of Isco Rock Shelter and Sathi Hills. The red portion is Rock Shelter. So it is the cross section of Rock Shelter. So here you can see, and one thing which I must say, that the government of Jharkhand, what they did, they cemented the floor, okay? And the, because of this unethical work, because done by the government of Jharkhand, we lost the archaeological deposits, which was here only. And we also found some microliths over here, okay? But unfortunately, because of this cement construction activity by government of Jharkhand, we lost it. Okay, this one is full 3D map of Isco Rock Shelter, and the total size of, so here you can see vertically it is 5.80 meters to 4.30 meters to 5.80 meters, and horizontally it is 28.7 meters. So we studied it by using digital methods only. So rock art of Isco is divided in two parts, pictographs and petroglyphs, where the pictographs or petroglyphs are very less. They are divided into two parts, simple lines or figurative, and figuratives are only two, anthropomorphic and zoomorphic. And pictographs are divided into two parts, figurative and non-figurative, whereas figuratives are very few, anthropomorphic, zoomorphic and floral. Well, it's the non-figurative, which is geometric patterns and linear motifs are more. So for the quantitative study of rock art, especially pictographs in Isco Rock Shelter, I divided it into six parts, started from A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and all are in 4.76 meters width. So it is the so the red portion which you can see over here are the rock art. So here you can see A portion has a very limited number of rock art, whereas B have little more, and C is the highest one. Okay. So for for the quantitative methods, and I wanted to know how many total depictions are there and which kind of depictions are there. So we draw a total XY lines, and we count each rock art by digital methods. So here this one. So in this section, you can see these are the rock art, okay, and other are not. And here, this one is section A. So this one, again, in it is a anthropomorphic form, decorated anthropomorphic form. Again, our anthropomorphic form, here you can see legs. We lost the head. And these are some natural holes which are depicted by, which were depicted by early humans. Here you can see this natural hole, okay, because of the weathering. And these are further decorated by early humans. Here some three kind of depiction are also there. Floral motif, sorry. Okay, this one is one of the interesting depiction. I interpreted it as a trap, hunting trap. Some early people interpreted it as a caterpillar. It can be both. Okay, it is the upper ceiling of section A. So here it is very less visible by using this stretch. Now you can see here, okay, these are some geometric patterns and decorated also. Okay, one of the important finding from my research is a paleo environment. Now, as you know that this rhinoceros or rhino is no more in Jharkhand, means in the natural form. So, but in during my exploration, I found some bones of rhino and one petroglyphs of rhino also. Okay, so it is one horned rhino or Indian rhino, Rhinoceros uniconus, which is a one horned Indian rhino depicted in Isco Rock Shelter in section A. So here you can see one zoomorphic figure. It is a picturegraph of a deer, okay, or a calf or a doe is present at the middle height of the western side of section B. Okay, it is in section B. Another, okay, here in by the help of this photo, you can imagine what is the present condition of Isco Rock Shelter. And why I started my research work in North Karampura Valley with Isco Rock Shelter is presently Isco Rock Shelter is one of the important attraction of the tourism in local area. And because of the anthropogenic destruction and high tourism activity and very limited knowledge of the people living nearby area, this rock shelter are in danger right now. So it is in section C. So here you can see high number of picturographs and a very high number of superimposition. So here you can identify the numbers of superimpositions. Here, this one is early. Okay, I also counted the superimposition by using digital method. And I found there are three phases of superimposition in section C of rocks, Isco Rock Shelter. Okay, it is one of the most important rock art which I found in the Isco Rock Shelter, and it is one of the most important rock art for North Karampura Valley. Why I'm saying this? Because it is picturegraph of mother giving birth to child. Okay, so I also carried out ethnographic survey. At least it was a 6-month extensive ethnographic survey in whole North Karampura Valley region, especially in Isco village and nearby areas. So these paintings are related with fertility cult. As you know that fertility cult was very prominent in the prehistoric society. Here you can see the small baby. So this one is a small baby coming out from the vulva. And here you can see sun also. Okay, so what I found in my research by the help of XRD analysis, that these are made on the same pigment only. Okay, means those the people who made this mother giving birth to child also made the same sun over here. So why they made same sun and the mother giving birth to child pictograph or anthropomorphic pictograph? Because with the help of ethnographic evidence, I also got the information that because of when the tribal people have believed that when they give birth to a child, it's depicted with sun, and if the female child is depicted with the moon. And I also found both moon and sun over here. Okay, so North Karampura Valley is one of the classic example of fertility cult in prehistoric society. So this one is men riding an animal. So this one is a line drawing of same pictograph over here. So here you can see big ear. Okay, here you can see now big ear and the horn. So so because of these things, tell and there is one rope over here. Okay, so because of this, so what I got information that those the prehistoric society who were living here in North Karampura Valley, they somehow knew the domestication and they started domestication, and it is the cattle only. Okay, because of the big ear and the small, big hair, big ear and this horn and a small tail. Okay, And the same ethnographic parallel is found in Sohrai painting of Hazaribagh district, and they consider is as a god. So it is another, the third important one. It is Assam roof turtle. Okay, I identified it Assam roof turtle because of these patterns, which this one is Assam roof turtle. So now Assam roof turtle is not present in Jharkhand. It is only found in the Assam region. Because of these evidences, including rhinoceros, Assam roof turtle, I also found the bison over here. So what I interpreted that there must be some kind of more wet climate in prehistoric period in Jharkhand region. I also applied for isotope analysis for the deposits in nearby region. Okay, so these are some anthropomorphic figures in present in North Karmapura Valley in ISCO site. Okay, just a minute. This one is just struggling. Okay, these are some anthropomorphic figures. Okay, these are two human. These are some mask. You can see eyes, teeth, and some human figures over here. These are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and this is some one of the unusual anthropomorphic figure. I could not identify it till now with the help of ethnographic study also. So it is monochrome red pictograph of male goat, okay, bison, Indian bison, which is also known as Bos gorses. It depicted in section D of ISCO rock shelter. These are some non-figurative or geometric figures. Okay, these are vulvas. Okay, three vulvas, and these three vulvas, the number of three vulvas are not only present in North Karmapura Valley or rock art of Jharkhand. It is also present in Chhattisgarh and Odisha region. And what is my interpretation that somehow this Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Bihar, and Jharkhand people means the prehistoric people were connected. Is it because of prehistoric movement or some sharing culture? I don't know till now. Okay, it is one petroglyph, anthropomorphic petroglyph in section F. Somnath Chakravarti identified it as just a female body, but I identify it as a male because of this turban and some kind of this sarutaru. Okay, this one is also a depiction of fertility cult. Here you can see three vulvas. Okay, moon, as I said, these are moon. Okay, and these interpretation are let me say that these interpretations are not given by myself. These interpretations are given by the local and the tribal people who are living in nearby regions and who have the stories related with this. So these are the total number of pictographs and percentage of pictographs. So here you can see that the highest number of rock art is present in section C. Okay, and the second highest in section D. These are some microliths. So what I usually see that those archaeologists who study rock art, they do not give lots of attention in the stone tools. But in my case, I also tried to do intensive studies on stone tools found in North Karmapura Valley region and the nearby region in the Selter region and open ear site also. Okay, so these are microliths, and all microliths are hand flake. Okay, so so the hand flaking of these microliths shows that they were earlier than Mesolithic era. So still we don't have the scientific date because of the less funding, but once we try to get scientific dates in our upcoming year also. So here you can see core, fluted nodule, okay, fluted nodule, some points. Okay. So Bullu Imam interpreted the rock art Chalcolithic, and Somnath Chakravarti interpreted it is Neolithic. And catchment area analysis also says that there are some RNA sites, like megalithic sites are also there. But what I found, there are some microliths, or I say microblades. I also found some microblades here. So now move on to ethnographic study. The past and present relics of rock art. The Hazaribagh district of Jharkhand is home of several Indo-Asiatic linguistics family. In present research, ethnographic study is carried out for interpretation of rock art with the help of ethnic art, Sohrai and Khor painting, and the belief system of Birhor, Orao and Munda communities living in Badkagaon block. So it is one Orao priest worshipping Dharmes, which is sun deity of Orao people. It is one Birhor man of who was actually settler of that Isko village only. So it is the Isko village, actually this one, no, it is Isko village. So Khor painting, these are Khor paintings. These Khor painting are made on a white surface and by using black pigments. These are Sohrai paintings. Here you can see anthropomorphic figures. This again, animal riding figure with fish and floral depiction. Okay, fish is one of the holy symbol also present in tribal society of Jharkhand and some Bengali culture also. So this suggests some of the auspicious occasion. And the Sohrai painting is usually made on the occasion of Deepavali only, or the auspicious season. Okay, and this Khor painting is made on the time of marriage. In Bihari society, it is also known as Khor, Kavar, or Kovar. So here you can see the ethnographic parallel of rock art. It is rock art digitally illustrated by D-Stretch and Illustrator. And here you can the present ethnic art. The description, the box shaped with the 12 triangles. Each triangle represent protection from the evil eye in ethnographic view. So I cannot say that, okay, it was same in present culture, because we cannot direct connect. It is the just general comparative analogy. And these are sun, okay. And the sun, which is you see here, okay. Sun headed. Sun, okay, and the sun is known as Singbonga, which is a god of Mundas people. Moon, okay, female called, okay. These are some these concentrated circle or moon are representative of fertility cult. Why I am saying this? Because this one, when I was going to Ranchi from Dhanbad to Ranchi, I found this. In the station, okay, and I asked some local people okay, what is this? So they said to me, it is for these are the auspicious symbols for especially for the marriage, and these are also auspicious symbols. These constructed circles are auspicious symbols, are just auspicious symbol or tradition or continuity of prehistoric to present. We don't know, but they can be. So as I said you that male riding an animal. Okay, let's move on to the open ear sites. So as I shared with you in a list slides that we have some open ear sites in nearby areas, and why I studied it, because of ongoing mining activity. So here is Pankhuri Barwadi coal mining project, which is also NTPC Pankhuri Barwadi coal mining project, and it is a plant of NTPC. Okay, So I it is very near to Palghanaw block. Okay. So these are some three localities. This it is the photo which I am showing you. It is locality number 2. Okay. So you can see the present condition of this site. So we found two layers of two archaeological layer where this second one is belongs to a middle Paleolithic. Okay, it is a cement. It is a basically fluvial deposit with a very fine silt and clay with the fluvial origin, and the one number is more finer. Okay. And the second number indicate that it is the primary deposit, okay, and very small and very little river flow and very little deposition of, so it is one of the primary site. So these are some middle Paleolithic tools. Here you can see a scrapper, working age, okay, and the core, fluted core, okay. Here some kind of bladelets, okay. Striking, you can see a striking platform over here, the striking platform over here, and this one, bulbar percussion. Here you can see bulbar percussion. Here you can see the bulbar percussion and the striking platform over here. On the next site is Pankhuri Barwadi. Okay, Pankhuri Barwadi is one of the most famous site of Jharkhand, especially known for megaliths. But I did not study the megaliths because of because I only considered the prehistoric period. But in Pankhuri Barwadi also I found microliths, and these microliths I consider it as micro blades. What is difference between microliths and micro blades? The microliths belongs to Mesolithic people, okay, dating back to 8000 to 2000 BCE before present, okay. But the date of micro blades are earlier than microliths. So all these are anflicts. Okay, I don't have a single microliths or a micro blades. Here you can see blades, micro blade. These are blades. Okay, all are made from the siliceous material using chalcedony, quartz, and okay. Here you can see blade, and this one blade is really too sharp. Okay, and cognitive science behind the rock art. I also try to understand why the people, prehistoric people, started making rock art, and what is basically iron. So I did one, you can say it, just a small work on, just a minute. Work on what is art. So I worked with three universities, especially with Kerala and some Santiniketan. Okay, and what I got, according to artists who study over there in Santiniketan and Kerala, that art is a cognition of art. Art is a medium of expression as well as the result gained from the expressions of emotions. Art is only possible by the virtual introduction of the emotions which turned into the expressions under human behavior. In the behavioral and the cognitive aspects of rock art, we can say that the type of non-verbal communication, what is basically, it is art is a non-verbal communication, and we can say that early rock art are the non-verbal communication of the prehistoric society. Rock art as shared art, if we consider rock art as a medium of communication, then by using a theory of basic communication model, one sender will be encoded and receive act as a decoder, and receiver will act as a decoder. In the manner of activity of coding and decoding, the rock art as the meta communication, okay, it will work as a meta communication. Communication without using words, and the non-verbal communication. Okay, the Morris argued that there is the first need of the development of language for development of sign. Okay, because we cannot share anything with the sign without having knowledge of language. So here we can give our hypothesis that those prehistoric people who were making rock art must have some kind of language. Okay. And I also use theory of mind, the application of sense perception and the event comprehensive theory. It is from the that rock art is reserved from the visual memory. Okay, so we have two kind of memory, visual memory and non-visual memory, and the rock art is a result of visual memory. We cannot depict anything without knowing something. Okay, for example, you cannot imagine, if I say you that just imagine a spaceship. Okay, you can imagine a spaceship. Why you can imagine a spaceship? Because you have some kind of concept of a spaceship in your mind. But if I speak with your grandfather or father of your grandfather, grandfather, that is imagine a spaceship. They cannot imagine a spaceship because we this is not had this means introduction of a spaceship, the knowledge of a spaceship. Okay, so what I argue that they must have some kind of knowledge of language. Okay, for a medium of a non-verbal communication. Okay, visual. So first, we need visual or non-visual expressions or to the memory, then mind mapping of something, then creation or expression. Okay. So, okay, the rock art and the mean, there are the three kind of meanings in rock art. First, in external meaning. Second one is operational meaning, and the third one is positional meaning. Okay. Okay, this one, it is one of the known Ostrich Excel from the partner. Why I'm showing this partner Ostrich Excel? Because here you can see some lines. It belongs to Upper Paleolithic. So Upper Paleolithic human who were living in India, they must know about the geometric art. Okay, and this one, this one is from the Usakoti. Okay, Usakoti is one of the famous rock art site in Sambalpur district, and this one is from ISKCO, okay, in Hazaribagh district. And the seed similarities between the rock art of ISKCO and the rock art of Usakoti. Here you can see this three kind of thing. Okay, three kind of thing, same one. Okay, here you can see this kind of depiction. Okay, some non-figurative depiction. The same depiction is over here, and this depiction. Okay, this depiction. This is over here, and the distance between Usakoti, which is in Sambalpur district of Odisha, and Hazaribagh is 423.7 kilometers. Okay, they did not have some kind of vehicle in prehistoric period. Okay, so it is still a question, and I'm trying to work over here. The now summary: ISKCO Rock Shelter has total 423 clear depictions of about 392 depictions, which is 92.6% non-figurative symbols. Okay, here you can see 92.6% are non-figurative, and only remaining which is only 8% or less than 8% are symbolic, non-symbolic or figurative depictions. So what Rampart argue that the use of more symbolic form in rock art may indicate to the ritualistic view. Okay, now what is ritualistic view, and what it is still a question, and we don't know that when we can solve it. So what is the further scope? We need to do more XRD analysis. We still don't know chronology. Still not a single site of Jharkhand is dated by using scientific technique. I tried, but that is too costly, and which is not available in India only. So I tried to work with Australia and America, and which need more funding. Okay, so need of the most semantic excavation and exploration, and the cognitive study of rock art, as it is very rich zone. Acknowledgement to the Professor S.G. Deo and Mr. Bullu Imam, Justin Imam, Pankaj Brahma Chaudhary, Yogesh Pratap, and special thanks to Dr. Seung-kyung Jung from the South Korea to help in 3D model. So now I can share with you 3D. I hope that you can see the 3D video.
Yes.
Sorry. Just a minute. Just give me 2 minutes, okay? Because of this, my computer became slow.
Then carry on. Take it.
So I work on the 3D documentation of Rock Circle. Why 3D documentation? Because what I consider that we need to preserve this rock art and the sites nearby region. And the 3D documentation will help us to making a digital register. And anyone in present or upcoming generation can access it. And after my whole work, I am also willing to make it open source, so anyone can use this data and access this data and give comment on this data. Is it visible?
Yes, okay. Shubham.
So it is the 3D form of rock art, score rock circle. Here it is section A, section B, this one is section C, which has highest number of rock art. So here you can see the destruction, okay? It is in the natural destruction and these are the anthropomorphic destruction. Here you can see still the tribal people worship this rock art site and they connect it with their ancestors. These are some rock art, okay, some pictographs. Here the non-figurative one in section E. We can blur. This is section B, so let's zoom in. Section B can blur. Where is here it is mother giving birth to child. Here you can see mother giving birth to child. Sorry, it's not working because only this 3 minute video is more than 1 GB.
Take.
Okay.
Ji.
So now I end my screen sharing.
बहुत 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 धन्यवाद शुभम, बहुत बहुत साधुवाद आपको, आपका प्रेजेंटेशन बहुत शुभम रहा, बहुत अच्छा रहा. और अभी क्या मैडम फतिमा जी ज्वाइन कर ली हैं? एक्सक्यूज मी
सर, जैनब फातिमा जी. हेलो सर, जैनब फातिमा जी इज अनेबल टू कनेक्ट विद अस, हर प्रेजेंटेशन हैज बीन रीशेड्यूल्ड टू द नेक्स्ट सेशन सर.
ग्रेट. तो ठीक है, तो ये मुझे लग रहा है कि हमारा ये सेशन जो फिफ्थ सेशन हम लोग और एंड की तरफ लेंगे. और अभी एक एक करके मैं थोड़ा सा शुभम जी. हेलो, आलिशा अली मैम है, कैन यू हियर मी
सर?
हेलो.
यस सर.
यस, गुड. योर प्रेजेंटेशन वाज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग मैडम, लेट मी टेल यू, योर प्रेजेंटेशन वाज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. Just I want to like to know what methodology you have adopted while doing your field work. Can you just explain?
Sir, actually, I didn't do any field work. Like, I didn't visit the site because, like, I specially wrote this piece of work for this conference. And since the announcement was made during the time of pandemic, so I didn't actually do any field work. But it was all based on the secondary sources that I could access through online. And I read interviews of all the archaeologists and people who worked on the site. So I went through all of that and then made this abstract out of it for the proposal of doing this research on working on museums plus archaeology both.
नहीं बहुत अच्छा लगा आपका प्रेजेंटेशन बहुत अच्छा रहा डीवी शर्मा जी की भी बात आई उनके साथ भी हम काम किए हैं बहुत अच्छा लगा थैंक यू अलीसा अली मैडम फिर हम आते हैं मैडम मिस भानु जी की पेपर की तरफ मैडम आपका आप यू हैव टच्ड अपन वेरी रिलेवेंट टॉपिक I really like the way of the connectivity with the tribal wisdom and their interpretation. Indeed, art is all about expression. Bharilian Aluminium ने भी काफी कुछ काम किए हैं उन्होंने और जैसे कि छत्तीसगढ़ tribal culture और tribal art and heritage पे उन्होंने बहुत सारे काम किए हैं मुझे लगता है आप उन किताबों को आप शायद पढ़े होंगे और दूसरा है अभी हम चलते हैं सुजान जी की तरफ मिस्टर सुजान दास योर पेपर वाज वेरी फैसिनेटिंग आई एम क्यूरियस अबाउट द अकाउंट्स ऑफ डॉक्टर हैमिल्टन यस यू हैव रेफर्ड इन योर प्रेजेंटेशन कैन यू प्लीज एलाबोरेट इट फर्दर
थैंक यू सर बुकानन हैमिल्टन विजिटेड दिस प्लेस इन द ईयर ऑफ 1808 He was first person, first archaeologist who narrated, who sketches a map of ancient Kamtapur kingdom and related to Kamrup kingdom of Assam.
Yes,
and
Kamrup.
He also described this kingdom as a buffer state between Bongo and Assam and Kamrup, particularly in those time, in early medieval times. But he did not actually visualize any adjacent areas. Later on, M.H. Bhatt, Rakhal Das Bandopadhyay, who visited this site, and who Rakhal Das Bandopadhyay indicate the chronology of this site back to the 9th to 11th century. Because we have seen that Ghen dynasty or Kamrup Kamta dynasty arose in this place in the 12th to 14th century. But Rakhal Das Bandopadhyay, who indicate that this infrastructure, this construction was actually built in earlier time. Later on, it is renovated and rebuilt by the Ghen dynasty. So, after that archaeological survey of India under Eastern Circle, Kolkata, they had carried out excavation in the eastern part of this citadel area. But they did not complete this whole excavation for unknown causes. To some unknown causes, they left this place until this dilapidated area remains same. So without a further excavation, we could not succeed to relate this Kamrup or Bongo and the settlement pattern. So I think there must have been there must need the further excavation in this site. So sir, you wanted to know me
great. And I would like to add something. Your extensive findings related to sculptural artifacts will definitely act as a connecting link in the archaeological discourse pertaining to Gosnermel Rajpat. Thank you once again, Sujan ji. Thank you. And hum log last mein aate hain. Great. Shubham ke presentation ke liye. Shubham ka presentation really bahut 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 sadhuvaad ki baat hai. Bahut Shubham raha. Mr. Rajak, I hope your extensive research finding will be a value adaption to the existing discourse on prehistoric rock art of Jharkhand. You have beautifully presented. Indeed, it's a great pleasure. If you examine the rock art, it actually shows a unique cultural continuity and symbolic representation of communication that is human and natural world. So अभी मैं कुछ भी आप लोग को जैसे कि पता है कि मैं इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स हूँ. सो आप लोग आईजीएनसी के बारे में भी आप लोगों को कुछ पता होगा, लेकिन लेट मी स्पीक अबाउट द इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स. ऑल ऑफ यू नो इंडिया इज वेल नोन फॉर इट्स रिच कल्चरल हेरिटेज एंड डिस्टिंक्ट लीगेसी ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड. May I take this opportunity at the outset and to tell about the aims and the objectives of the Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. IGNCA is a potential wing of Ministry of Culture, Government of India, which is a center encompassing all forms of arts, each art form expressing its own significance, which mutual interdependent and interconnected with nature and cosmology. जैसे कि अभी बहुत अच्छी तरह से सुजन शुभम जी ने बहुत अच्छी तरह से आर्ट को नरेट किए हैं. आर्ट इज लाइफ, द क्रिएटिव एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ वैरायटी फॉर्म्स ऑफ आर्ट बोथ विजुअल एंड परफॉर्मिंग आर्ट्स, ओरल ट्रेडिशन, फोक एंड क्लासिकल लिटरेचर, पेंटिंग्स एंड स्कल्पचर, आर्किटेक्चर, मेटेरियल एंड नॉन मेटेरियल कल्चर व्हिच आर एनरिचिंग इंडिया, इंडियन लाइफ इन मेनी डायमेंशंस. एंड माई इंस्टीट्यूशन IGNCA सीक्स टू प्लेस आर्ट्स विद इन द कंटेक्स्ट ऑफ नेचुरल एंड ह्यूमन एनवायरमेंट, रियलाइजिंग इट्स इंपोर्टेंस intangible and intangible cultural heritage as stressed by the UNESCO. The fundamental approach of the center is to reflect its worth in its multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary approach. Art, both the theory and practice, prayoga and shastra, as well as in the practice, stem from a single unified living tree of Indian culture, sustained and nurtured in varied dimensions of life. The worldview of art has been crystallized into some fundamental concepts which reflect deeper understanding of the cosmos of space and time, of center and periphery, of the part and whole of the body, sense and sense mind, to interlink science with philosophy and arts requires an interdisciplinary approach which is the first prerequisite. IGNCA is committed to explore these fundamental concepts which reflect holistic vision of distinctive art forms of India in worldview whose survival is threatened today in the era of globalization. So far, most researches have been done in single discipline without understanding the interconnector of all these fields which are lacking at present in the 21st century. So this is our about aims and objective of center, Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. Before concluding, so हम लोग जैसे कि हम लोग यूपी से गए, छत्तीसगढ़ से फिर बंगाल गए, फिर आए हम लोग झारखंड से बात करते करते हम उड़ीसा की तरफ गए. प्री हिस्ट्री की बात भी कर रहे थे, उड़ीसा की बात कर रहे थे हम लोग, ऑल ओवर भारत वर्ष की अभी बात कर रहे थे. मुझे अभी मैं अभी जगन्नाथ कल्ट, जगन्नाथ कॉन्शसनेस के बारे में, उड़ीसा की जो आत्मा है, जो आर्ट एंड आर्टिफैक्ट कल्चर संस्कृति सारा जगन्नाथ टेम्पल, जगन्नाथ कल्चर के साथ बेस्ड है. बिफोर कंक्लूडिंग फर्दर लेट मी ऑल्सो डिस्कस अबाउट सैक्रेड हेरिटेज ऑफ जगन्नाथ and its tribal and regional cultural interface. The Jagannath culture is the most ancient natural heritage of India. The different rituals of Sri Jagannath temple are ecosensitive, which directly or indirectly promote protection of the environment and bear immense significance in promoting intangible natural heritage of India. The different rituals observed in the Jagannath temple uphold preservation of the distinct traditional knowledge, oral traditions, and ritual practices observed by the different tribal communities of Odisha, like Saura, Pond, Santhal, Gond, and many others. These best practices need to be essentially preserved, documented in the context of intangible natural and cultural heritage, as well as through conducting empirical field-based research and visual documentation, which has not been initiated in this field as yet. Let me share with some experience. As you know, the one of the most important ritual of the Jagannath temple is Navakalevara of Lord Jagannath. आप लोगों को पता होगा ये नवकलेवर ऑफ लॉर्ड जगन्नाथ कभी कभार 8 साल में इसको किया जाता है, कभी कभी 12 साल में, कभी कभी 19 साल में, अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस एस्ट्रोनॉमी उसी के हिसाब से किया जाता है। और जैसे कि आप लोगों को पता होगा 1996 में लास्ट 2015 में नवकलेवर सेरेमनी हुआ था। इट्स ए 4-month रिचुअल, कभी इनसाइड द टेम्पल होता है, बहुत सारा रिचुअल आउटसाइड द टेम्पल, एंड बहुत सारा जो उन लोगों जितना सारा ये जो 4 महीने का जो रिचुअल है, इसमें सिर्फ दैता लोगों का, जो लोग जो सवराज जो अभी हम ट्राइबल की बात कर रहे हैं, उन्हीं लोगों का पार्टिसिपेशन रहता है। एंड 2015 में इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ कल्चर के माध्यम से एक पिक्टोरियल डॉक्यूमेंटेशन का डॉक्यूमेंटेशन उसमें 4 महीना तक, मंथ्स तक भाग लिया। वो ब्यूटीफुल, उनमें से कैसे ट्री को कैसे कटिंग किया जाता है जगन्नाथ जैसे दारू ब्रह्मा, बट ट्री को कटिंग करने का उसका रिचुअल, उसमें हवन यज्ञ, और दैता लोगों का जो ट्राइबल लोगों का उनका उनका जो मंत्र उनको जो मंत्र के साथ साथ उनको स्वप्नादेश होता है, उसके बाद ट्री को छेदन किया जाता है। बहुत ब्यूटीफुल रिचुअल है ये चीजें को। और फर्दर कभी ये हेरिटेज सोसाइटी, कभी हम लोग हेरिटेज सोसाइटी के साथ हम इसको डिस्कशन कर सकते हैं। और लास्ट दिस 3-day सेमिनार विल बी पाथफाइंडर फॉर एक्सप्लोरिंग न्यू स्ट्रेटेजी एंड डायमेंशंस, डिफरेंट इंटरेक्शंस, डिस्कशंस, फीडबैक्स, शेयरिंग ऑफ न्यू आइडियाज एंड एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ द स्कॉलर्स, एकेडेमिया, रिसर्चर्स एंड एक्सपर्ट्स विल बी इमेंसली यूजफुल टू इनिशिएट फर्दर रिसर्च एंड डॉक्यूमेंटेशन। विथ दीज वर्ड्स आई वांस अगेन congratulate Dr. Ashutosh Dwivedi ji and Sri Azhar ji and all the panelists. I want to send thank you and thank you all. And last, just yes. Is there anything, Shubham?
I just want to make some comments on your Jagannath cult. The earliest evidence of Jagannath cult from rock art. Professor Somnath Chakravarti has studied the cult of this cult and he also found the palace of this Jagannath cult in Rock Art in some parts of this Sambalpur region. He found the same pattern in Rock Art.
Yes.
So.
Thank you. Why not?
So one question is from Didwandi ji. He wanted to know how my journey of this topic. Okay, actually I am from Jharkhand, and I am personally connected with the culture and tradition of Jharkhand. As Misra sir is from Odisha. So
I am from Odisha, working in Jharkhand. Yes. Yes.
As sir is connected with Jagannath cult, so I'm also connected with the culture of Jharkhand, and Binudi is connected with the culture of Odisha. Sorry, Chhattisgarh.
Chhattisgarh.
Yes. So in our Deccan College, we know that S.J. Sangalesan, when he takes his PhD scholars, he always says to his researchers, his PhD scholars, to work in his own region, his own village, or his own state. So that's why I selected this topic and I started work in Hazaribagh. And I will straight my work in Ranchi also. I'm planning to work in Ranchi region and other part of. And other question, what is, okay, dating of rock art, there are two types of dating, okay. First one is direct dating, which is the scientific dating, and second one is relative dating. Relative dating is by using the artifacts or the relative material culture, associated material culture, what we call it. So with that and the scientific dates. The scientific dates works with the use of scientific techniques. There are many various dates like carbon dating system and luminescence dating system, others. And it depends on the nature of rock art and the nature of site. If charcoal is used in rock art, then we can use carbon dating technique. If not, then other dating technique. It will depend on the nature of rock art. Is there okay? Sipla Wadinkar is asking me about the pigments, okay, and ethnographic parallels of pigments. So yes, I worked on pigments. I worked on pigments, especially ethnographic pigments. I worked on this portable XRF analysis of both. This rock art and ethnic pigments, but still we don't have result because of the lead from the institute or the institution where I given my sample. So soon, within 6 months, and we will get some clue about the pigments also. And this, okay, and this Siv Kumar KV is asking me a question that there are tribal protection of cave paintings. Actually, there are no protection of this cave painting. Not ASI is doing any work to work with the rock art of Jharkhand, neither local villages. Only Bullu Imam is trying to do that, but because of this activity by Bullu Imam, local people are visiting that site and they are touching and harming the local rock art. So it is not protected yet, which need to be. Is there good. Any other question? I think
so. You can directly, you can answer them with your emails, etc.
If anyone has any question, then anyone can email me.
They can email you. Yes. Thank you once again. Thank you, organizers. So हम लोग आगे चलते हुए, क्योंकि आपको ये भी चीजें बता दूं, इस सेंचुरी में ये जो आने वाले 100 साल में नवकलेवर ऑफ लॉर्ड जगन्नाथ हर 19 साल में वो रिचुअल को होने वाला है. तो हम लोग वो जो 2015 का जो रिचुअल के बारे में, नवकल जो इतना बहुत बड़ा जो रिचुअल है, उसके बारे में कभी हम लोग इसे हेरिटेज सोसाइटी के माध्यम से फिर हम लोग ऐसे ही यूट्यूब में जुड़ेंगे और डिस्कशन करेंगे. थैंक यू एंड ऑल द बेस्ट इन फ्यूचर. नमस्कार.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
At the end of this session, I take this opportunity to express my deepest gratitude to Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra, sir, who, despite having his busy time and busy schedule, he took out time to spend some time with us and accepted our invitation to join this session and moderate the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. I also congratulate and thanks to all our presenters who joined us today for their very wonderful presentation. I also thank our viewers who are live on YouTube channel and watching us in this session. There will be one more session after this that will start from 2:30, which will be followed with keynote address, and there will be a cultural program. I request you all to stay tuned with the YouTube channel of Heritage Society. I thank all of you. A special thanks to Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra, sir,
and
joining the session. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.